Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Santa Cruz Regional Transportation Commission meeting. This is March the 4th. And can we go ahead and begin with roll call?
Commissioner Bertrand?
Present.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Here.
Commissioner Montesino? Commissioner Caput?
Here.
Commission Alternate Schifrin?
Here.
Commission Alternate Mulhern?
Here.
Commissioner Koenig?
Here.
Commissioner McPherson?
He had trouble last time.
Here.
Hey, there he is.
Commissioner Peterson?
Present.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Here.
Commissioner Rockin?
Okay, well, thank you, folks. We have a quorum. Next on the agenda is oral communication. Any member of the public may address the commission on any item within the jurisdiction of the commission that is not already on the agenda. The commission will listen to all communications, but in the compliance with the state law, they may not take action or on items that are not on the agenda. Speakers are requested to sign in and state their name so clearly that their names can be accurately recorded in the minutes of the meeting. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to give 3 minutes this time around to the public. So is there any public that would like to speak? Please raise your hand and you'll be identified.
Mr. Brian Peoples.
Hi, thank you. This is Brian from Trail Now. Thank you for the sharing the train derailment at Manresa Beach in 1978, multiple train cars crashing into homes in the Selva Beach area. This derailment took place in an area with few houses close to the tracks and at slow speeds. The train was traveling 5 miles an hour. Imagine trains traveling 45 miles an hour through our neighborhood, 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. Imagine the consequences of 60 trains a day through Capitola, Aptos, Libo. We believe heavy traffic, train traffic, transportation should remain on the highway corridor, not through our neighborhoods. Please, how about we start having a conversation about realistic use of the coastal corridor for transportation resources? We need to talk about when will we use the coastal corridor. Opening the coastal trail for alternatives for biking, walking, running is critically needed for our community. The facts show that it is possible to have an interim coastal trail started this year and complete it by 2023. Rail banking has been recognized by the RTC as a means to preserve the coastal corridor for future transit. RTC has stated that 100% of the rails have to be removed for any future transit system. Any future public transit system along the coastal corridor is decades away due to the cost. We ask you to support building an interim coastal trail from Watsonville to Davenport by 2023. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Peoples.
Mr. Michael Saint.
Go ahead, Michael.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. Good morning, Chair Gonzalez and Commissioners. Michael Saint from Campaign for Sustainable Transportation. Something a little different. Let's talk about climate change today. I'd like to share with you a letter that was in the January-February Sierra Club magazine. Just imagine that you're in the year 2030 and we're looking back over a pivotal decade in human history. Allow me to paint a picture for you of the energy transformation that is possible. Number one, first, we powered the country with 100% clean energy. An electric grid powered by clean energy was the foundation of turning the corner on climate change. Number two, we got well on our way toward electrifying everything. Here in 2030, one of the best parts of energy transition is that it has made our lives healthier. COVID-19 made Americans realize the importance of walkable cities and accessible public transportation. Congress included funding and infrastructure bills for clean and affordable public transit, biking, and walking options. Thirdly, we stopped attempts to expand drilling while we reclaimed abandoned wells, mines, and drilling sites. Fourth, finally, we engaged millions of people in the work for climate justice. Let's be clear that none of this was very easy. In summary, we were unafraid to go after not just Republicans who were denying the validity of climate science and supporting misinformation campaigns, but also Democrats. We said to them, you too have not done enough on this issue. You have said you believe the science, you have voted the right way, but truly, we need champions. We need fighters. We need people who are ready to stick their necks out on issues, who will fight day in and day out, will be the leaders that we so badly need on the critical issues and talk about them from racial and economic justice perspectives. What's crucial is being willing to call for the level of action you want and we need as your citizens to mitigate climate change, no matter what your political affiliation is. We have yet, and please do not take this personally, not found any champions on this present RTC commission. We really hope that you will walk the walk instead of just talking about it. I hope you don't take it offensive, but I've enjoyed the talk and thank you for listening.
Mr. Barry Scott, then Barry Pico.
Go ahead, Barry. Oh, no.
Great. Okay, thank you. I wanted to speak to the rail transit business plan and the TCAA. I think it's clear, after all, every study that we've conducted indicates that rail transit on the right-of-way is the best investment across every dimension and every criteria. And we want to, you know, build for future generations as well as solve current problems. However, we know that the cost is high, and I think that everyone's concern is really around cost, not mode, not vehicle type so much, but what is the cost of this? And I encourage commissioners and staff to be sure to include a rapid streetcar type of vehicles similar to the TIGM type, which will, you know, indicate, which will represent present and coming technologies that are lighter and less expensive to implement and operate. Maintenance of the rail infrastructure, it's so important right now as, you know, Measure D began with a healthy, robust, I think it may have been higher than 15%, but I remember as it was reduced to just 8%, we've been spending a lot of that Measure D 8% money on studies and maybe not as much as we might on rail infrastructure. And I sincerely hope that we will not neglect the rail line, because as more storms and things occur, we need to take care of that infrastructure. A conversation about rail banking would seem to suggest moving in an opposite direction, it would signal a weakening of our resolve and commitment to maintain that line. And it's a bit early, I think, to consider rail banking if what we're trying to do is create, preserve the integrity of the infrastructure and implement rail at any time in the future. And finally, I know that we're looking for a replacement for Progressive Rail, and we know that Roaring Camp is interested. A local company with local employees and local interests, and I think they'd make a fabulous partner, not just for providing freight, but also the fact that they will have an interest in the entire rail line and permit staff and consultants to conduct the kinds of operations that need to be done. Right now, I don't believe that the RTC has any vehicles or any capacity to get out to every part of the rail line, unless you were to rent or find a high rail truck. If Roaring Camp is our partner, you can be sure that they will help the RTC get out to any part of the rail line for inspections and for work.
Thank you, Barry, for your time.
Thank you.
The next speaker.
You're muted, Yesenia.
You're muted, Yesenia.
Mr. Kerry Pico and then Faina Segal.
Mr. Kerry Pico is recognized. You there, Kerry?
I see it now. Thank you. Okay. My name is Kerry Pico. I live in Aptos, Rio Del Mar. I've been testifying at the RTC since 2014. In all this time, I've been allowed 3 minutes unless otherwise announced. Last month's cutoff of my presentation was unprecedented, an insult and a loss for the commission. Second, a commissioner stated trail advocates should, quote, check their white privilege, unquote, an insulting racist statement on its own. Let me tell you about my white privilege. I grew up in a broken single parent home in San Diego, welfare, shopping, the Goodwill, government powdered eggs. My neighborhood was not privileged. Among the kids I grew up with, one went to federal prison, another killed in a drug deal, and another suicide. As to my home, police visits were regular. My brother and sister were each sent to county homes for the incorrigible, never graduating high school. My sister died of a heroin overdose. It messes with your head, it leaves scars, but I was smart enough not to huff spot remover, or worse. Mine was not a life of white privilege. I made it to college. Before you talk about white privilege, check your own. I survived. Better still, I accomplished far beyond my means. That's my rear view mirror. That is my privilege. I know it and I'm grateful. That is why I try, not just here, but as some of you know, elsewhere in the community to improve those around me. Lastly, I come here repeatedly because I see great failure in the RTC, an organization that has created controversy where none existed before. Its expertise is disappointingly skin deep. Take traffic, for example. The RTC uses it to justify its trains ambitions, but doesn't have the basics. For example, the RTC stated for years only 15% of Highway 1 North traffic heads on Highway 17 North towards the Bay Area. Had it looked at the Caltrans data, it's 50 to 60%. That's a factor of four difference. That wasn't a mistake. That was an intentional misinformation or intentional ignorance used to justify how millions of dollars are spent each year for ideological rather than data-driven goals. The same can be said about a lot of RTC misinformation. So yes, I will be back again and again with my 3-minute presentation unless you cut me off. I look forward to seeing you, seeing each of you in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pico.
Faina Segal.
Faina, you're recognized.
Good morning, Chair Gonzalez and commissioners. My name is Faina Segal. I am the board chair of Santa Cruz County Friends of the Rail and Trail. I just wanted to welcome and congratulate Capitola's past mayor and current city council member, Kristen Peterson, for being selected by the Metro Board to represent the interests of Metro and all the people who use Metro's countywide public transit system every year. On behalf of the entire VOR organization and our thousands of supporters countywide, we look forward to working with you to create a more robust public transportation system that will transform our county into a more equitable, sustainable, and prosperous county. Welcome. Thank you, Chair. That's all I have for you now.
Thank you.
Chair Gonzalez, we don't have any other hands raised, but I do need to make a correction on my roll call. I did not call Commissioner Scott Eads.
Okay. So there's been a correction on the roll call.
I take it that they're here, right?
They're here, right? And Eduardo hasn't showed up yet?
Yes, Eduardo is now on as well.
Okay, good. Well, welcome aboard, commissioners, and apologize for that oversight. We're gonna go ahead and we're gonna move on and we'll move on to item number three, which is additions or deletions to consent and regular agendas.
So thank you, Chair Gonzalez. Yes, there is a replacement page for the agenda. It doesn't change the content of the agenda, except that it fills in Kristen Peterson as the additional commissioner instead of to be determined. There's also replacement pages for item 4, which are the minutes from last month's agenda. Those are posted on our website, and that is all of the changes.
Is there a question or a motion to accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
Or is there any comments that anybody would like to make on the consent agenda? From the public?
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second.
We should wait, ask the public again.
Is there anybody from the public that would like to comment on any item on the consent agenda?
We have
Janet. Good, Janet, we recognize you. What item would you like to speak upon?
You'll need to unmute yourself, Janet.
I would like to move item 7 to the regular agenda.
Is there any commissioner that would like to do that?
Well, she should say something about why.
Yeah.
Because there is no consideration for handicap parking in that project, and I'm a person in a wheelchair.
Thank you.
Can I just clarify here a little bit? I think this is something that I understand the importance of handicap parking. But again, that is something that I think the city of Santa Cruz needs to address, and not this commission. It is there in their jurisdiction to address those issues. So I feel, and I feel we should continue to keep this on the consent agenda. Unless there's any other commissioner that feels differently and wishes to pull this item and put it on the regular agenda, now is the time.
Well, I would suggest rather than pulling it, give her 3 minutes, give the person who called in 3 minutes to say what she was going to say if it had been pulled. She gave a very brief statement, but I think she should have additional time.
Yeah, if I could, I think that makes sense. Just Sandy Brown, the city rep, it would help me understand so I can talk to our staff about it as well.
Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and allow her to speak 2 minutes on this consent agenda item. Janet?
Okay. The project is to replace some drainage in the area on Pacific Avenue and Front Street. And that particular street is the most level in that area. And there is no handicap parking, especially for van access where parallel parking doesn't work. And you are putting in extra motorcycle parking. There's some perfect places on Front Street for front-end parking that would allow handicap parking to be put there. There is little handicap parking in that area. And it would be advisable when you have all the people out there doing street work to add some handicap parking. And I'm in a wheelchair and I would appreciate something to be done with that project. That's all.
Thank you, Janet.
Mr. Chair, I'm not sure the order, but I'd like to ask a question if I could on this topic. You can tell me whether we want to pull it and talk about it later or now. That's up to you.
I'm leaving it up to our commissioners. If any commissioner wants to pull this item,
I'll pull it just so I can ask my question. I guess I don't know
how. I don't think you need to pull it to ask your question.
I think you can just ask your question, Mike.
Thank you. I just wanted to make whatever you'd like. So
yeah, no,
my question is, when we have a claim, this is a basically a. Transportation, it's a claim for $50,000. Is this after work is completed or money that's going to the city to allow them to proceed with the project? That's a question to our staff, I guess.
So Commissioner Rockin, this is a TDA claim. It's for transportation development money, which is limited to bicycle and pedestrian improvements on this project. It cannot be used for parking of any kind. The project, I believe, has multiple fund sources, and there are other things that could be possibly done with this or other projects. And that's why, you know, when I had briefed Commissioner Gonzalez that the city had said that they are willing to look into the disabled parking issue, but it's really unrelated to the TDA claim that's in front of you as part of this consent item.
Thank you. I'm on board, and I understand that the first, I don't believe her name is Janet, should go to the city of Santa Cruz to talk to them about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Watkins. Okay, so we have a motion, and Sandy, did you have a question?
I just wanted to make a comment here to Janet. If you want to reach out to me, I can try to help facilitate that conversation. We have talked about the project, and I'm happy to try to help get your perspective in that conversation. So just contact me at my city of S. Brown at cityofsantacruz.com, and we can connect that way. Thanks.
Okay. Well, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Motion by Jack and a second by Andy. Roll call.
There was a motion by Commissioner Schiffer and second by Commissioner Bertrand. Okay, Commissioner Bertrand.
Muted.
Commissioner Bertrand.
I'm sorry, I was muted. Aye.
Commissioner Brown.
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson.
Aye.
Commissioner Montesino.
Aye.
Commissioner Caput.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Schifrin.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Mulhern.
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig.
Aye.
Commissioner McPherson.
Aye.
Commissioner Peterson.
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez.
Aye.
And Commissioner Rockin.
Aye.
We're going to go ahead and now move on to item 17. This is the regular agenda and the commissioner's reports. Do we have anybody's commissioner report? The commissioner's electing. I don't see any hands. So we're going to go ahead and move on to item number 18.
Mr. Chair, I have an item I'd like to mention.
Okay, go ahead, Jack.
Sorry, brief. Yeah, so with the derailment picture that we saw, I'd like to remind the commission and the staff of the commission that ever since I've been on, at least, we've raised a concern of the trestle over Soquel Creek. And at that time, George promised a report on that. So we're still waiting for a report on the viability of that trestle and what its limits are, because there are many houses actually below that trestle. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Is there any other commissioners that like
that? Commissioner
Rockin. I hear somebody. Yeah, I wasn't going to comment on it, but a picture of a freight train with massive cars and the weight one assumes of a heavy locomotive is not what anyone is thinking, at least and no one I'm aware of is thinking about in terms of what we would put on this corridor in terms of passenger rail. So it's more than a little misleading to show us a picture of a wreck from a freight train from a couple decades ago to imply that that's what we're thinking of running on this. And it's really misleading to the public when we're talking about, you know, something at the weight of, I don't know what it would be, perhaps what Barry Scott talked about, a trolley car of some sort, or even if it were light rail, it would be a very different kind of a animal than that. So it's a little misleading and not particularly helpful to the public debate. That's my only comment. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Is there any other commissioner that'd like to make a report or a comment at this time? Hearing none, seeing no raised hands, I'm going to go ahead and move on to item number 18, committee appointments. Oh, that's me. On this note, I'd like to nominate Eduardo Montesino to the budget and administrative. And I think Manu Conan is also wishing to be placed. I will be taking the coastal corridor. I'm sorry, I don't have that in front of me right now.
Coast Rail Coordination Committee.
And Bruce McPherson wished to maintain his commission, his committee commission. Is there any one other one I'm missing?
Commissioner.
It's Ryan Coonerty wanted to stay on the Budget and Administration Committee.
Okay.
And I desire to do that too. If there's no spot for me, that's fine, but I still was interested in staying on.
Okay.
Well, there would be one too many appointees. If Eduardo was appointed and Manu was appointed.
I'll back off. Thank you, Executive Director. I'll back off. I didn't know that there was too many. I did want to continue, but if these others are interested, I'll definitely back off. Thank you.
So for clarification purposes, I have the five Board of Supervisors and Eduardo Montesino as being nominated to Budget, Personnel and Administration. And then I have Commissioner Gonzalez being nominated for the Coast Rail Coordination Committee. And then I believe it's actually Commissioner Friend who is appointed to CalCOG. And he's wishing to continue.
Yes.
So are these appointments or nominations?
Nominations.
And in that case, I'd like to move the chair's nominations into it.
Second. I'll second that, but I have a question. Normally, doesn't the chair just appoint rather than making the nominations in the commission have to appoint? I don't remember having to vote on these appointments in the past, but maybe I just forgot.
Good morning, commissioners. This is Luis Mendez. It is correct that the chair does, and I don't even call it a nominator appoint, but the chair does make the designations, but with concurrence from the commission. So then a motion for concurrence of the commission is certainly something that would be in order.
That's my motion.
And I'll second it.
Thank you. We're gonna do a roll call.
Commissioner Bertrand?
I agree.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson?
Aye.
Commissioner Montesino?
Yes.
Commissioner Caput? Commissioner Caput, you're on mute. Okay, we'll come back to Commissioner Caput. Commissioner Alternate Shiffrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Alternate Mulher?
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
Aye.
Commissioner McPherson?
Aye.
Commissioner Peterson?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Rotkin?
Aye.
Commissioner Caput?
Okay, well, thank you. It's been approved.
Silence is consent, so I think that's a yes vote unless he calls back to correct it.
There he is. Commissioner Caput, we were looking for your vote on the nominations for the committees. Yes or no? You'll have to unmute yourself, Commissioner Caput.
What do you need?
We're looking for your vote on the committee appointments for the Budget and Personnel Committee, the CalCOG, and the Rail Coordinating Committee.
Oh, you need the vote. Okay, I'm sorry. I guess I was muted. Okay. Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, commissioners. We're going to go ahead and move on to item 19, director's report.
Thank you, Chair Gonzalez and commissioners. I have an announcement of Metro appointed RTC commissioners at Santa Cruz Metro's board meeting on February 26th. Metro approved the nomination of Kristen Peterson as Metro's final appointee to the RTC, joining Chair Gonzalez and Commissioner Rodkin as one of Metro's three appointees. Kristen is a City of Capitola Council member. Welcome, Commissioner Peterson. Metro also approved the appointment of three alternate RTC commissioners, Shebre Kalantari Johnson and Larry Pagler and Donna Lind. For the rest of my report, I'm going to provide some observations on the transportation landscape that I've kind of seen during COVID from the beginning to where we're at now. We've all been experiencing various impacts to our daily routines due to the coronavirus pandemic. Notwithstanding the need, desire, and ability to experience the freedoms related to transportation. Transportation provides freedom to move, but often this freedom comes with certain pitfalls. How free are we if we need to spend hours of our daily lives stuck in an inefficient commute? Soon after the virus arrived in California, all but essential workers were told to stay home. Freeways, once clogged with back-to-back traffic, became virtually empty. By being afforded the new freedom to work from home, many non-essential workers were freed of the perils associated with their once often grueling daily trek, only to now feel trapped in their own homes. So it didn't take long before routine congestion returned to Santa Cruz. Highway 1 is experiencing regular congestion. Highway 17 still appears to be a little bit less congested during the work commute, but it backs up on weekends as tourists continue to seek freedom by escaping their homes and traveling over the hill to Santa Cruz for a day. Our Metro buses have continued to serve customers throughout the pandemic. They have employed new safety and prevention measures onboard their vehicles and at their transit centers, including face mask requirements, plastic sheathing between rows of seats, increased cleanings, and a limit on the number of passengers depending on the size of the vehicle. Metro is currently offering free fares to COVID vaccination appointments. Nonetheless, Metro's ridership is still well below pre-pandemic levels. Metro expects that riders will eventually return, but there will likely be changes to usage patterns. Metro is utilizing an opportunity provided by the decrease in ridership to conduct a pilot program of on-demand microtransit open to the general public. This program could help provide very useful information about demands for transit in our county. To help encourage ridership, Metro is also implementing a temporary fare reduction program, which would discount all adult and youth fares by 50% and provide free fares for riders with an eligible discount fare. Metro projects this proposal could increase ridership by 20%, by lowering the financial burden of transportation for customers who need it the most. One of our biggest changes that I've observed is the number of people using active transportation modes, such as walking and biking. Within the active mode, we are seeing an entire new class of electric personal transportation vehicles, with e-bikes leading the way. In promoting this new e-bike legislation, which provides a tax credit to individuals who purchase an e-bike, Congressman Jimmy Panetta acknowledges that due to the distance, speed, and ease by which they can travel, e-bikes will help replace vehicle trips and commutes and reduce carbon emissions. E-bike sales are booming and Santa Cruz appears to be fully on board. It is therefore extremely important to further advance active transportation infrastructure projects as part of our overall strategy of a balanced multimodal transportation system. This concludes my report.
Thank you.
Commissioner Gonzalez, we have a community member with their hands up, a few community members.
Okay, we're gonna go ahead with the community members. And any comments or questions on the report by the executive director?
This is Commissioner McPherson. I just wanna say thank you for what Metro has done. The ridership is down about 85% plus and that's understandable, but they have gone to great efforts to accommodate those in need, and they're going to allow free transportation for those that want to get a vaccine, a shot. So Metro has gone above and beyond what it really has to do, and I really want to compliment the administration of Metro and the board members, of which I'm one, but we're trying to continue the service, very essential services to our customers. Very much appreciated. We thank you, Metro, for what you're doing.
Thank you, Commissioner McPherson. Is there any other commissioner that'd like to comment or have a question for the executive director on his oral report? Seeing none or hearing none, I'm gonna go ahead and do the public now. Is there anybody in the public that'd like to comment or have a question for the executive director on his report?
Brian Peoples, then Michael Saint.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Great news on the e-bike tax credit from Congressman Panetta's. We gave him a message of support for that. We're actually met with his office and we're meeting with them again tomorrow. I do want to comment, and e-bikes are a game changer for our community, and why we absolutely need the coastal trail opened ASAP. That is going to be a game changer for our community. The study showed that there would be 800 users an hour along the corridor, and that's essentially almost half of a single highway lane capacity. So it will be a game changer for our community, and letting that property sit unused for decades is not appropriate for our community. I do want to make one other comment in reference to Commissioner Rodkin's comment about trains through our community and his view that it's
Mr.
okay.
Mr. Peoples, this is on
it's not about that. It's basically the trains are multi-ton vehicles. They're smart trains.
Mr. Chair, you should enforce your rule. You were being reasonable and just not on topic.
All right, yeah. I'll stop. Everybody's got the message that thank you,
12
people
Mr.
have died. Thank you.
Mr. Michael Saint, then Barry Scott.
Good, Mr. Saint.
Thank you, Chair Gonzalez. I want to take a little exception to Mr. Preston's comment about feeling trapped in their homes. My wife works at Stanford, and this has been her most relaxed year. She's not had to commute except for one day a week versus three or four times a week. She can take breaks at home and occasionally goes for walks. And I think most of the people may feel trapped if their social life revolves around their work. I can understand that. But for our point of view, things are much better with the telecommuting. You don't need to make that drive to do just as good a job as you do at work. When she goes to work, she's basically trapped inside her office because it's so busy. She's a nurse coordinator on oncology. So I really think, as a suggestion, RTC should pursue telecommuting as an option. The best thing anything can do about transportation is to get cars off the road and not widen it to put more cars on the road. I've seen the traffic come back. I agree with Mr. Preston on that. Emphasize its use, the telecommuting, especially for those going over the hill. So that would mean the RTC would get some type of program, maybe do an ad hoc committee to get in contact with the larger businesses. Google, Apple have buses. Stanford does not. A lot of the medical places do not. So those would be good people to talk to, as well as our own local people. So, and I do agree with the e-bike program. I think that's a super thing. I hope we really pursue that as well. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. States.
Sure. Barry Scott, then Mr. Vernassa.
Thank you. I just wanted to mention that I'm excited about e-bikes too, and I hear sometimes this binary argument that because of e-bikes and electric vehicles, we might not need public transit quite so much, which I reject. And I hope all of you understand that these good ideas are not mutually exclusive. As regards working from home, and again, I was on a call a month or two ago with Bart, the BART director on the call, and she was pointing out how things have changed with respect to the most popular stations. And they found that pretty much the poorest neighborhoods, the stations in the poorest neighborhoods where essential workers are likely to need transit, are now the most popular stations. And those financial district types of stops where people can telecommute are less busy. So let's not kid ourselves. Essential workers need transit, and people that can't maybe afford electric bikes and electric vehicles and all this fun stuff, or are lucky enough to have a job that they can telecommute from, they need transit. So let's resist the transit versus bikes arguments that we hear, and let's embrace all of the above. And boost, and thank you, Metro. Good grief, I love Metro, and let's remember to support our Metro and think of an inclusive, multimodal, integrated networks of transportation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Scott.
Mr. Vernassa.
Okay.
Recognized.
Hello.
Hi, Ben. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, first of all, 4 months ago, when I talked, I thanked the commission because 20 years ago, I was 40 pounds more than I am now, and I got a chit from Iacocca for $350 to buy one of his bikes, which I did. I'm 87 now. I bike every day. It's wonderful. There's a problem, though. There's so many new bikers in Mid-County. It's getting dangerous. Somebody's going to get injured badly or worse. The trail between Capitola and La Selva Beach is 7 miles long, and there's only 6 cross streets. That's what we need. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
There are no other hands raised, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Okay, thank you. We're going to go ahead and bring it back, and we're going to go out and move on to item number 20, Caltrans report. Scott, you're on.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the commission. I'm Scott Eads, here for the district director today. I have 2 items for you. The first is that we have our first ever District 5, Caltrans District 5 active transportation plan out for public review. It's been a very intensive effort. It's involved a lot of input along the way from a technical committee, and now it's out for public review. The plan identifies locations where bicycle and pedestrian improvements are needed along the state highway system. It's really focused on the state highway system that exists in District 5. And the plan is based on a thorough inventory of our roadways and the real estate we own throughout District 5, and a focus on where bicycle and pedestrian needs exist. We took into a lot of factors into consideration in doing so, and we're now looking for additional input from the public. We received early input in the process, and now we're looking for input on the plan itself. And I do want to highlight that the plan itself is a summary document, and then it includes a web-based interface where it has mapping. It's called a story map that provides additional information on other conditions that might influence bicycle and pedestrian use on our facilities, and other factors associated with where we should be prioritizing those efforts. So look forward to any input that you receive. The deadline for comments, it's been out since February 8th, and the deadline for comments is quickly approaching on March 9th. And the plan and the comments can be provided if you go to www.catplan.org. There's a District 5 tab there at catplan.org, and that's where you can interface with the plan and provide comments. Second item that I wanted to provide an update on is the Highway 1 closure at Rat Creek. As probably all of you know, we had an event in January that took out about 150-foot portion of Highway 1, a full closure. It was related to the fires that happened earlier in the year, and then inundation of water that we received in a single storm, which took out a portion of the highway. And so the good news here is that we have been assessing technical options for fixing that location. We've come to a conclusion that a enhanced fill with culverts can be replaced at that location. It's the most efficient and effective way to get the work done. And we expect to have the roadway open in early summer, which is great news for those that want to travel through that area or for those business owners and residents in that area. The cost we're anticipating to be around $11.5 million. And there's other improvements around the area as well that we're working on. The highway will remain closed during the time until it's fully reopened. We need to allow the contractor to have full use of the site and preserve the safety of those in those in that area. And it'll allow us to get the work done quickly. All businesses and activities south of Rat Creek, including Lucia, Gordo, Tree Bones, Ragged Point, San Simeon, Cambria, and Point South are open. And that the entirety of Route 1 is open on the Big Sur coast, except for a small portion right adjacent to Rat Creek on either side. Happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you, Scott. Is there any questions from the commissioners?
Yes.
Commission recognizes Andy Schiffer.
Hi, yes, thank you. I appreciate the report. I have reviewed the active transportation plan and for the district, and it does, while it does provide a lot of very interesting information, useful information, it's on a fairly large scale. So some of it is difficult to understand what areas are really included. I'm particularly concerned about Davenport. There's a really strong need for a pedestrian bike connection between the old town and the new town. The Regional Transportation Plan Commission's rail trail is scheduled to stop at Old Town, and the National Monument is going to have an access point off Cement Plant Road, which is a county road, but there's a link between Old Town and Cement Plant Road that's along Highway 1 that is very dangerous, or quite dangerous now. And it's unclear from the plan whether it includes that, one, whether it includes that stretch, which I think it really needs to, and two, what kind of a priority it has. So it seems like the North Coast of Santa Cruz projects don't have a very high priority, and I'm concerned about that, both because of that connection and because the Pacific Coast bike route runs down Highway 1, and having just rode my bike up to Davenport recently, there are some pretty hairy sections where the shoulder is pretty narrow. So I wonder if there's someone I could speak to in the District 5 office to or who would be willing to get in touch with me so I could get the information about what's going on in Davenport. It may be covered, it may not be covered. It was just too general for me to tell from the document itself. So I'd appreciate somebody contacting me to clarify the situation.
Did you want to comment at all, Scott, on that? Or?
Yeah, if I could, Mr. Chair, that'd be great. Yeah. Yes, happy to follow up on that. Maybe just a note in terms of the context of the plan. This is the first effort at this scale. There's a lot of roadways to cover. We did try to take into account and considered all the different planning efforts at the city and the county level and in the regional, you know, RTP, for instance, documentation. That was an input to our process, and the plan does not identify specific priorities. That's a follow-on process. It really, the intent is to identify the areas of greatest need that will lead to prioritization in terms of funding and consideration in terms of other project efforts that are being programmed. So understand that in some locations, the detail may not be as specific as we would desire for, you know, a very specific project context, but we want to be able to take the plan information into context as projects come along or as efforts are being considered. But either way, that's the kind of input we're looking for. We'll make sure, and I'll have somebody from my office follow up with
right. And the reason I wanted to follow up is because my understanding is the active transportation plan is going to be used in evaluating project applications. So whether it's seen as a high need area or a low need area, that's going may be important should there be proposed projects that, you know, maybe a high priority here, but if they don't show up as being important in the plan, they may not be much of a priority to Caltrans. So I appreciate your willingness to have somebody get in touch with me about the Davenport situation.
Sounds great.
Thank you. Is there any other commissioner that'd like to
ask
a question? Mike?
Yeah, Highway 9 got a great deal of attention from Caltrans, thankfully, and local agencies, particularly Chris McPherson's office, supervisorial office. I guess what I'd like is to make sure that Caltrans contacts the community activists that you were already in contact with around the Highway 9 issues around active transportation. I don't expect you to know off the top of your head exactly what's planned for Highway 9 in this thing, but it would be really critical that these people know they have a right to give you some input before you make your final decision about that active transportation plan. I'll put for my own two cents, it should be a very high priority. And as I said early on, Caltrans put a lot of effort into that, and I think the local community appreciated that, but we found it's a very complex issue for, you know, in terms of driveways and slopes on both sides of the road being steep and so forth. So it's not a cheap project to fix the active transportation, but it has a lot to do with school kids going to walking along the road and bicyclists that are running into like diagonal parking as they ride along the road and a bunch of other kinds of stuff. So, I mean, I think it's critical that the people that live in that, I don't live in that community, but the people who do know that they have a chance to weigh in on the question of how high a priority and what exactly is understood to be the need along Highway 9 in this plan. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Commissioner. Go ahead, Scott. You want to respond?
Yeah, if I could respond to that. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just say that there are a lot of efforts on Highway 9 happening right now, both project efforts as well as consider a project initiation document that's actually being sponsored through SECRTC. You absolutely agree. There are a lot of complexities there and a lot of challenges that result in potential real estate, right-of-way takes, as well as other really, high-cost improvements. So it's a challenging environment, and I think that the team members are really taking it seriously, and there's an interest in trying to figure out how to do it best. So, there has been public meetings recently related to those efforts. And I believe that Supervisor McPherson was directly involved in some of those. So appreciate the input that we received. And certainly any additional input on the plan itself is appreciated as well.
I don't know whether Caltrans itself could send some kind of messages to people, letting them know of this opportunity to comment. Again, to the names, not expecting to go out there and do a bunch of research on new names, but the people that you've already been in contact with in the community, they're fairly well organized, so if you hit three or four of them, I'm sure you'll eventually get to be aware of what their opportunity is here.
Thank you. Is there any other commissioner that has any questions or comments on the Caltrans report?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mr. McPherson.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mike, for bringing that up. And yes, we have continuing conversations going on. And it's a huge project, a very difficult one to correct, but We're going to continue that effort and get public input. So thank you for your input. And Mike, you were right there at the start from the concerns we had at the fatality that we had there a couple years ago. I just want to say to Caltrans, thank you and congratulate you for the safety improvements. I think about $19 million worth that you've just completed in the 6-mile stretch between Scotts Valley and the summit. The safety improvements will be very, very, they are being very well received. I want to also just say I do recognize there's many, many programs that are on the list of funding opportunities in the 5th District, my district in Santa Rosa Valley, and the North Coast District of Supervisor Coonerty. And It's very much needed, never needed more before in the aftermath of the CZU fire. So I appreciate those continuing to go up the ladder on the list. So thank you for those efforts and look forward to more improvements in the near future.
Thank you. Is there any other commissioner?
If I get a chance,
Mr. Cabot. Go ahead, Mr. Cabot. Commissioner Cabot. Okay.
Thanks, Chairman Gonzalez. I want to thank Scott, you and your staff for the wonderful job on a project update here at Marchant and East Beach, which is part of Highway 152, right by the high school. The pedestrian activated crosswalk, they've done a great job out there. They put in the lights that are activated when the high school kids are off campus during lunchtime and in the morning and the afternoon. So anyway, it looks great. And they finished up, they enhanced the crosswalk also, and they put warning signs up. And I think it's gonna be a great help. It's a, it was a safety concern for a long time. So thank you. And I want to thank the city of Watsonville also for letters of support on this, and of course, county staff and Board of Supervisors. So thanks a lot, Scott.
Thank you, Commissioner Cabot. Is there any other commissioner that has any questions or comments on the Caltrans report? Hearing none, seeing no raised hands. I'm going to go ahead and go to take it to the public.
Brian Peoples and then Mr. Vernassa.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. You know, I want to concur with Commissioner McPherson's comments about Highway 17. I remember the efforts that you did years ago in closing down some crossing over the road. So I think that you all have done a phenomenal job on that. So thank you. On the active transportation solicitation, we made comments, but I will say that my experience, and I think the general public's experience, is the comments usually don't go far. They never go far from that. I mean, we don't really get a response, and you never really change the path that the public agency is taking. You're not alone. There are other agencies like that. But I will take the time here just to mention again our advocacy to actually, when the widening of Highway 1 in Aptos occurs and the two railroad crossings are removed and replaced, we're recommending that you actually keep the rail corridor along the ocean side and then just have one crossing over into Aptos Village bridge crossing. And then what we also recommend is that the southern trestle that is on the southern part of Aptos Village, rather than having that extend to a bike lane, a protected bike lane between Soquel Drive and Highway 1, that would go all the way to the Aptos Junior High and possibly all the way to Aptos High School. That would be phenomenal when they widen the highway, that you put a bike, protected bike lane between Soquel Drive and Highway 1. So appreciate again you taking the time to come to the commission. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fields.
Mr. Vernassa?
Mr. Ben Vernassa?
Go. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes. Do you have any questions or comments on the Caltrans report?
Absolutely. In October, I mentioned after Scott's presentation about the trestle that has the fence overhanging the freeway, which is a distraction for those people going south, looking at it, and they're not keeping their eyes on the road. And Scott called me a couple of days later, and he sent out a crew, and 3 days later, I got a report back that that is true, but it's not their responsibility, it's the RTC's responsibility. So I sent that off to the RTC and for action, and it's still there. When are we going to fix that? It's a distraction for people driving south. They take their eyes off the road. I've had that comment from many people. Thank you.
In response to what?
I'm thinking
to when you're going to fix it. When you're going to fix it?
The repairing of the fence.
Yeah. Oh, the broken fence. Okay.
Yeah, the broken fence on the rail overpass.
Gotcha.
I don't see any other hands up, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Thank you. Thank you, Scott, for your report.
Oh, wait. Thank you for all the. I'm sorry. There was another person who lowered their hands and just raised their hands. Michael Pisano.
Yeah. Hi, Michael Pisano, SoCal. Just real quick on the southbound 17, right before the Paso Pinto exit on 1C, there is a digital sign that has a speed limit sign 55 right in front of it. So it's basically ineffective. So you don't see it until you come right up on top of it. So I was wondering if something can be done with removing that speed limit sign in front of the digital sign. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael.
Okay, now we, Michael Saint.
Go ahead, Mr. Saint.
Thanks, Chair Gonzalez. Yeah, this brought up a thing that's bothered me a little bit on my biking. I'm in the unincorporated area of Santa Cruz County. Zach Friend is my commissioner. So maybe this is a question for the alternate Commissioner Mulhern. Basically, along the San Andreas road, basically after Seascape up to Larkin Valley and through Manresa parking lot area and beyond, we have a lot of eucalyptus trees.
I don't want to interrupt you, but we are on the Caltrans report. So
well, I was wondering if it was a Caltrans. Yeah, I'm wondering if it's a Caltrans priority. Do they deal with that? It's basically they never clean the shoulders, so you have to ride in the car lane.
Yeah, since that's a county road, I would imagine county responsibility.
Maybe Mr. Mulhern could give me a call, or I can call in and ask him.
Okay. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
I do not see any other hands, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to bring this back, and we're going to go to item 21, projects update from Santa Cruz County Department of Public Works. And staff, Steve Weinzner, I'm sorry if I act that name.
That's okay. It's actually Steve Wiesner.
Wiesner.
I'm happy to be here this morning. I would love to share my screen if I'm able to, Yesenia. It looks like I'm not able to. There we go.
No, excuse me.
Perfect. So let me know when y'all can see this.
There you go. It's coming up.
We see it now.
We got it.
Great. Well, thank you for having me. Good morning, Chair Gonzalez, commissioners, Director Preston, and members of the public. My name is Steve Weaver. I'm the Assistant Director of Public Works here for the county. And I'm pleased to be here to give you an update on transportation-related projects within the unincorporated area of our county. I usually do this type of update once every 2 to 3 years, but actually I think it's been since October 2016. So I have quite a bit actually to cover today. The focus of my presentation, we have a lot going on countywide, obviously. But the focus of my presentation today will be on projects that have been funded wholly or in part through your commission and will consist of a Measure D program update, recently completed projects that are currently in construction, projects that we have under development, and I'll touch a little bit on the future needs for our county the way that we see it for our local road network, and then hopefully there'll be some time for Q&A again. Okay, so Measure D. This is new since my last update to y'all, and we're very appreciative that this got passed by the voters in our county in November 2016. And, you know, it provides a huge amount of transportation funding countywide for a wide variety of projects. The county's share is part of the neighborhood and streets portion, and we estimate around $2.3 to $2.5 million a year. And we've been using this funding primarily for resurfacing of local roads and of neighborhood roads. It had been a couple decades since we had any kind of a good pavement management program on the neighborhood streets in the unincorporated area, And so we're happy to be able to deliver these projects utilizing this critical funding. And so we've put out three projects since Measure D came on board. We're doing them annually. And we've got nearly 20 miles now of neighborhood streets resurfaced in this program. Right out the gates, though, this came on board right after we had the huge storm event in early 2017, which actually in South County destroyed one of our bridges down there. And so we used just a little bit of Measure D funding, a couple hundred thousand that was slated for South County to replace this bridge. Pretty critical that we did that. And we were able to get that done in 2017. And then moving on to 2018, we started putting out an annual project. And what I'll say is that we are, as best as possible, trying to equitably share this money across our geographic region. And so 2018, we saw some neighborhood streets up in the Miller Hill, Miller Cutoff area, that's up in the Summit area. We were able to do some streets down in La Selva Beach. We got part of Martin Road done up in the North County area. There's the Casterly Bridge as part of that first slate of projects. And then we're able to do some roads in downtown Boulder Creek. You'll see a little bit of a theme here. We're going for sort of core village areas or town areas to begin with. And so 2019 saw some roads in Live Oak. We're able to hit some roads down in the Rio Del Mar Beach Flats area. I think the photo here is Beach Drive. You can see before and after. We completed Martin Road in 2019, and then we were able to do some streets in the downtown Dunlop area. 2020, which is just this past year, we did some streets up in the Thurber area, that's the Santa Cruz Gardens area of the Incorporated Live Oak area, and then we were able to get some roads done in Sea Cliff Beach area. We started a project on Lakeview Road, and we were able to get some roads paved in the Felton area. So what we've got slated for this summer are some streets up in the Merlin Way area. That's actually off SoCal San Jose Road by the high school there, by SoCal High. We're going to be able to do some roads down in Corralitos. We're going to finish off Lakeview Road, which is down in South County. And then we're going to hit some more streets in sort of the downtown area of Boulder Creek. Okay, moving on to some of the projects recently completed. And I say this is within the last 3 to 4 years because it's been so long since we spoke. But we're utilizing some critical funding really through your commission, and I just want to thank your commission. I can't thank you all enough for providing some of this critical federal resurfacing dollars that we're able to hit some of our federal aid routes. So roads, this project was a fairly large project that did the entire length of Granite Creek Road and some of Brent's 40 Drive. Granite Creek, much like Glen Canyon, these are roads that connect Highway 17 down into the central part of our region. So that they have become commute routes at this point. And so really important for us to take care of these. And we're able to fully rehab Granite Creek Road through this project. And you can see we use some of that local partnership money, which is a direct result and benefit of our voters passing Measure D. So that's fantastic new funds that come into our area that we're able to put to work right away. This was a real long project, had been planned for the better part of a couple of decades that we were able to bring to fruition and complete in 2018. This utilized a lot of leftover RDA funding from that RDA area near the harbor there. And you can see, I mean, it's fantastic. It's being used today. It really organized the parking out there. It provided really great pedestrian facilities and sidewalks, bike lanes and so forth. And we built a roundabout to the entrance to the harbor there. And had a lot of water quality benefits, of course, working with Coastal on this project as well. So we're grateful we're able to get a little bit of RSTP funding on this project to help complete it. We've been very active in the Aptos Village area for the last many years. If you've driven through there, you've probably seen a lot of the construction activity. And we have two critical signal projects that we've been working on. The first here at Chalk Gulch and SoCal Drive. And this was actually one of the last stop-controlled intersections on SoCal Drive. It's definitely one of the more congested areas of SoCal Drive, which is one of our main arteries through the area. And so getting the signal up, and it's pretty tricky, this area working so close to the railroad. And, you know, we had to construct the crossings to all the modern standards and so forth. It's pretty tight. I think folks weren't real sure whether the signal was going to actually do what it was intended to do. But once we got it up and running and we kind of fine-tuned the operations, I think it's working really well in the area. So we're really happy to be able to deliver this again with critical federal resurfacing dollars here on one of our main arteries. And so we actually, the projects we have in construction, I'm just going to parlay on that Aptos Village project here. So this is the phase two of that project, which is basically installing a signal at Aptos Creek Road. This is the entrance to Nicene Marks and the entrance to some of the new development that's happening in the village area. And again, critical federal surface transportation dollars to match some of the local developer fees and some local funding there to bring this project to completion as well. We're just towards the end of construction on this. We anticipate we'll be done by end of spring or beginning of summer. And I will note that as part of these two projects, we've actually put wire in the ground and we've connected all the signals together in this corridor. So that would be Trout Gulch, this new one we're building at Aptos Creek Road, signal at Spreckles, and then actually moving on all the way up to State Park Drive, we'll tie it in the signal at Rancho Del Mar and then at State Park Drive. And then we're going to come through after this, all this is done with an adaptive management project through an airborne grant that we received, which really should help to fine tune the operations and the timing of all these signals working together. And so we're hoping that it'll really help reduce congestion in this area and help traffic operations and safety as well, because there's a lot of pedestrian and bicycle improvements too. Okay, yeah, this again, and I'm just going to reiterate how grateful we are for the federal resurfacing dollars that come through your commission to help us bring these types of projects to our communities. This is probably the largest single resurfacing project that we've had in the county for a couple of decades now, close to $7 million. We're able to do 26 miles, and just to give you a little bit of a gauge, we've been averaging 4 to 5 miles a year through the hard times the last couple of decades. You know, we really think we should be doing about 50 miles a year. We have a 600-mile road network. And if we could get to close to 10% every year, we feel like we can take care of the roads in pretty good shape. But we haven't been able to do that, as your commission is aware. But with Measure D and with these critical federal resurfacing dollars coming towards us, we're actually putting out large projects now that will have a huge impact on the quality of our roads and our community. So this one's actually still in construction. We weren't able to quite complete it last year due to the fires and some other things that delayed this project. But we'll come back in at the end of spring once we're sure that the rainy season's over and we'll finish this project up. But this project represents like a huge, huge step forward for us, and we'd like to kind of continue that trend. Okay, so some of the projects that we still have under development that we're looking towards building more funding for so we can complete. This one's been on the books for a while. We have it just completely designed. All the right-of-way has been purchased. This will be a fantastic project in the Seacliff Village area. And it's really a streetscape improvement project. And it'll come on the heels of a large utility undergrounding effort that had been happening out there for many years as well. That work's pretty much complete. And this project really aims to organize parking in the area and provide increased pedestrian and bicycle safety as well. It'll really spruce the area up quite a bit. And because we basically got it shelf ready, we have all our permits, we've purchased all the right of way we need. And really at this point, we need to start working on building up our construction funding. So that's going to be a goal of ours over the next couple of years to seek additional grant funding so we can bring this project to fruition. Okay, this is intersection improvements down in South County. I would say this is our number one priority for transportation related projects in the South County. For sure, we've been working on this project for quite some time. And as you can see, it involves quite a bit of funding sources to build a bank up to get this thing done. We're in partnership with Caltrans on this. They own two legs of this intersection, the 152. And we know that there's traffic operation problems down there. We know that there's big queues in the morning going towards the school, and we know that there's big queues in the evening coming back into town. This project's going to really help that out a lot and also improve safety for bicycles and pedestrians. And this project is nearly complete in the design phase. We have all our environmental done, and we're very close to completing the right-of-way. We think we'll have that done by the end of this fiscal. We still do have an additional need. We've made a couple runs at different grants to try and complete the funding for this project. unsuccessfully, but we are in the process of trying to turn over as many rocks as possible to see if we can come up with some local funding to get this thing out of construction this summer. It's a very important high priority project. Okay, touching a little bit on the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Scenic Trail. This project is just getting underway. This is segments 10 and 11. And it kind of excludes some of the areas in the city of Capitola, more complex, getting over the river trestle that is not in this project. And this is a great project we're working in concert with RTC on. It's a partnership. We've got an initial seed money of Measure D to get through the preliminary design and environmental phase of the project. We estimate that'll be done. It's just kicking off right now. We've got a consultant on board. And so probably in the next year and a half or so, we'll be done with that preliminary design and environmental phase. And at that point, we'll be looking to do the final design and looking for construction dollars as well. I will mention also, just as a note, that we are working, we don't have any funding necessarily through the RTC on this, but we're working on segments 8 and 9 as well in partnership with the city. And that's just starting to get into the design phase as well. Okay, oh yeah, this is a fantastic project. Another great partnership with the RTC, and really want to compliment the RTC, Director Preston and his staff. In particular, I think Ginger Dykar really helped us write a fantastic grant. We won just a huge amount of local state money for our local roads. And this is just a portion of the larger project, which I think is in the neighborhood of $100 million that we won for the entire county and Highway 1. And I believe this project was kind of born out of the Unified Corridor Study, which recommended buffered bike lanes, pedestrian improvements, transit priority, and these types of things. And it's on a large segment of Soquel Drive. Again, Soquel Drive is one of our main arteries through the county. I've heard it referred to as Highway 2 many times. This is actually, I think, 5+ miles of Soquel Drive that runs all the way from the city of Santa Cruz to State Park Drive. And so we're really excited to get underway with this project. We have an RFP out for design services. In fact, I think that the proposals are due today, March 4th. So we're excited to rapidly get into this project. It has a very aggressive schedule, and we'd like to get into construction 2022 on this. So we'll be working very, very hard on this project over the next year or so. Okay, just gonna touch a little bit on future needs, the way we see it here for county roads. I didn't talk a lot about this, but in 2017, and I think your commission knows, certainly our entire board knows, what a big year that was for storm damage to the county maintained road system. By the time everything was said and done, the end of February 2017, we had over 200 sites that were damaged and over $100 million worth of work to do. And so it's a huge effort. It's been a large focus for myself and for my team. And in spite of the pandemic shutdown and the CZU fire impacts that we experienced last summer, we're still full bore ahead. And we've got most of the biggest, baddest ones repaired, but we still have about half of them to do. And so we're just gonna continue plugging away on that. But about keeping our eye off of the pavement management ball, and we're gonna, as many dollars as we can get into our pavement management program, we will put that on the streets as quickly as we can. We see the impacts that the program that we've been able to implement the last couple of years, and what a positive, impact that has been for our communities. So we're full bore ahead on that as well. We're continuing to work on safety improvements throughout the county, a lot in the rural areas, replacing old dilapidated guardrails, installing new striping standards and new signage and that type of thing. And then active transportation work that we are currently actually in partnership with Ecology Action and the Environmental Health Services Agency here in the county. We won a planning grant a couple of years ago from Caltrans. We're real appreciative of this. And so what we're doing is we're creating an active transportation plan for the entire unincorporated road system. And it's really focused on, what's our existing inventory and what is our vision for the future when it comes to pedestrian and bicycle facilities and it's totally focused on county roads, but looking at links to other jurisdictional facilities as well, like the rail trail, obviously, and our neighboring agencies. And then, we're continuing, we're quietly continuing to work on our bridges and large culverts. I think you probably all have seen that nationwide, we have a pretty bad grade when it comes to our infrastructure, and our county's no different. We manage and maintain approximately 150 bridges and large culverts that pass our big creeks and our rivers all the way to the ocean. And we've got over a dozen bridges right now in design for replacement. So we work very closely with Caltrans and with FHWA on these projects. And our goal is to get about a bridge every 2 years. And we'll be continuing that on through the next couple of decades to bring our bridges up to standard. And then last but not least is our signal operational improvements that we've got planned for the county. We operate somewhere around 46, 47 signalized intersections in the unincorporated area. There'll be one more once we bring out Toss Creek Road online. And what we've been doing, what we've been up to, is trying to upgrade all of our controllers and the digital stuff along with the physical hardware that's out in the field to bring everything up to a modern standard so these things can really start to speak to each other and we can optimize the operational aspects of these signalized intersections to get folks moving through these and these intersections as best as we can and create as much safety as we can. Okay, so with that, I just really, I want to thank, first I want to thank my staff. I have a fantastic staff. They come to work every day. They work really hard through all this calamity that we've been through the last few years. We're still delivering projects to the public. And when we get funding thrown our way, boy, we really put these projects out. So in particular, Russell Chin, Casey Carlson, Tim Bailey and Greg Jones, those are my senior managers. And these are the folks who actually deliver these projects and work through all the problems to get them completed. And I want to thank Matt Machado, who's the county's public works director. He's been with us for a couple of years now, and Matt's fantastic. He provides critical guidance on all of our projects. And he's really instrumental in the partnership that we enjoy with the RTC. He sits on a lot of the project delivery teams for projects that RTC is involved with. And he's involved with everything that we do. Director Preston, his staff, he has fantastic staff, very professional. And in particular, I'd like to throw a shout out to Rachel Morricone. Rachel continues to provide our local agencies and your commission with extremely accurate and up-to-date information on current state and federal transportation funding and legislation. She's like invaluable to us. And anytime I have a question, basically, it goes to her first. And then, of course, last but not least, I want to thank your commission. Y'all continue to support our county's transportation infrastructure. And, of course, without your support, we wouldn't be able to meet the critical needs of our communities. And we wouldn't be able to bring these projects to fruition. So thank you. And we continue to look forward to continuing our work with you. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions that your commission may have.
Thank you, Steve. I'm going to go ahead and we can open it up to the commissioners, and I recognize Mr. Commissioner Greg Caput.
Okay, how you doing, Steve?
I'm doing great, thank you.
Okay, I miss seeing you down at the county office in person, but anyway, thanks a lot for all your help. I wanna thank your staff, Public Works out there on Grimmer and Houlihan at the county yard over there. They've done a great job. Some of it maybe is not even our responsibility when we get close to the creek beds and all that. They've been cleaning out a lot of junk and stuff. I actually went down there last week and there's a homeless guy that's been there for a long time and he goes back and forth. He's panning for gold and maybe one day he'll find some. And, but anyway, with him doing that, we had a pile of junk there right by the, creek bed, South Spades Creek, and, your staff cleaned it out. It's good to see. Yeah, and the other is did a great job on the Casterly Bridge that we put out there by Smith Road at probably about half the price as we'd originally thought it was going to be. That's because of you and your staff and engineers looking at it and coming up with a better alternative at a much cheaper price. Highway 152 in Houlihan and College, you had a little picture there. Is the only thing holding us back right now is still the lack of funding. We have the plan, but we had a grant application that fell through. Did we applied for another grant. I don't know how that's going.
Yeah, we're actively searching, and you're right. We missed out on a couple of grant opportunities. We'll keep trying everything we can, Supervisor Caput, but we are searching internally as well to see if we can bring that project to construction this summer. So more to come on that.
How about how much we're still short? About what, $1 million, a big round figure?
About $1.5 million, yeah.
$1.5 million, okay. All right. I'll keep talking to you on that, and we'll see how the... But we have a grant applications in, right?
The last one we had in, we found out that we did not get it.
Okay. Okay. Thanks a lot, Steve.
Thank you, Mr. Caput. Commissioner Caput. Manu Koning, recognize Manu, Commissioner.
Thank you, Chair. And thank you, Steve, for the great presentation. Just want to particularly the projects resurfacing Granite Creek Road and Branch of 40 Drive, those are major streets in the first district. And so I know those are really important to a lot of residents. Also really excited about the Soquel Drive, the 5 miles of buffer bike lanes that are going in. It's great to hear that we could start construction as soon as 2022. That's really cool too. I just want to make sure I understood you correctly on some of the funding challenges we're facing. And you said the goal would be to resurface roughly 10% of our county roads every year. So you said 50 miles of about 600 miles total. But currently you said we can only cover about 26 miles per year. Is that right?
So actually that 26 miles, and if you combine that with the Measure D work we did this year, it was 30 miles. But this is like a banner year for us in any single year we've seen in the last 20 years. We've been averaging, so prior to Measure D and prior to SB1, we were averaging 4 to 5 miles a year. And the last 3 years, we've been averaging about 15 to 20 miles a year. We still think that's obviously far shy of what we need to maintain our system properly. You know, it's 600 miles, and so roughly 10%. If we could get 50 to 60 miles a year done, and you know, that'd be various applications from chip seals in the rural area to like, you know, larger pavement projects in the higher dense areas. But yeah, we're still far short of what we think we need, but we're doing everything we can with what we have.
I completely appreciate that you're working in a resource constrained environment. So it sounds like we've basically got a little less than half what we would need to maintain the system that we have today. And, I think some of the presentations you've shared with me, it looks like with our current funding environment, we're basically looking at continued degradation of county roads. And of course, they get more expensive to maintain as they get in worse and worse shape. So, definitely a challenging environment, and I appreciate you doing everything you can. My next question is about the signals in Aptos. It's, I think they're both around $3.5 million, both the one recently completed and the upcoming one. I'm just curious, like how much of those costs were for accommodating rail in those crossings?
That's a great question. It's about $500,000 to $750,000 is what it's taken to build those crossings. They vary between Trout Gulch and between Aptos Creek Road. They're both a little bit different, but just call it about $500,000 for each of those crossings. So they're quite expensive.
Right. So specifically for the rail portion, because it's
correct.
Right. Thank you. And then I just want to point out, segments 10 and 11 is kind of cool to see that rendering of the bridge next to the rail bed. Of course, there's also some challenges there. I noticed there was no pedestrians in that rendering. And it's one of the challenges we're seeing on the on segment 7A built over on the west side is, you know, the reality is the current plans for the rail trail are combining bikes and pedestrians, you know, in an environment where you've got these fences on both sides. My understanding is I believe someone broke their arm on the west side this weekend trying to dodge some pedestrians. They were on a bike. They went into the fence and broke their arm on the fence. So it's kind of a scary environment to ride a bike in, you know, when you're moving fast and you've got these walls on both sides. And I just want to point out, I'm pulling up the fact sheet for segments 10 and 11 on the RTC page. That estimated total cost is about $66 million total for those two segments, and we still need $62 million of that. So I just want to, you know, point out to the commission, we're directing county staff to do work on these design documents for which we basically don't have the funding to actually build the proposed designs. And so, I think it's critical that we look at, you know, updating the direction to create realistic plans as soon as possible, and especially ones that separate bikes and pedestrians to create a safe environment. That's all.
Thank you. The chair recognizes. Did you want to answer back, Steve, at all to any of those?
No, just thank you for your comments, Supervisor.
Okay. The chair recognizes Mike, and then Patrick, and then Andy.
Okay, I have two comments. First, following Manu, I want to appreciate the work on Grants of 40 and Granite Creek. The pictures, if anything, understate how bad Granite Creek and Grants portions of those roads were. And in the before picture, it looks like it's cracked a little bit and stuff. It doesn't show you the potholes. And I ride my bicycle up there regularly up towards Scotts Valley and the summit, and it's made a huge difference. Again, fixing these roads means that we'll avoid huge expenses in fixing them years later when they finally collapse if they're not dealt with. But the problem for bicyclists is right now. And these fixes, you just notice the difference hugely when you do these resurfacing projects. They make just a tremendous difference. And for safety, among other things, those are really narrow roads without even decent shoulders. And so if you're on your bicycle, you do not want to be swerving around a pothole that would, you know, bury your front tire when you're being maybe into oncoming traffic, even on Granite Creek, for example. On the second question, I want to kind of disagree strongly with Manu about the segment 7. I use that regularly, and my neighbors use that regularly, and that's been a tremendously successful project. And I think a lot of people sort of made the comments that it's not the ideal bike path for them, or it's not as good as it could be, or there are these risks. That's not my experience of it. There's like hundreds of people using that thing every day, and they get along fine, and the bicycles, and it's a lot easier to ride, for example, than Westcliff Drive, which has got also shares pedestrian and bicycle use. And it's been a tremendously successful project that's deeply appreciated by our neighborhood. So those of us, I think, using that thing regularly have a different experience of it than the picture the man who was painting of the, you know, dangerous aspect of the thing. That's not the way people experience it. The most difficult part of that experiences the crossings, and that would be a problem for anybody's vision of what a bike path and pedestrian path might be along there. But I've found for the most part that traffic's pretty good about stopping for people. It's well marked. So as you ride your bicycle along it, you know you're coming to a road that you have to be careful about where you're crossing, and the pedestrians see that. And it's well marked for the cars that you're about to, like, you know, you're driving over a place where there's likely to be bikes or pedestrians coming across. As I said, those crossings are going to be an issue. We don't have the money ever to sort of imagine building bridges over or tunnels under the road crossings for each of these little neighborhood streets, sometimes just a block apart. So I think that trail project's been incredibly successful and appreciated by the neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Patrick McColl.
Thank you, Chair. And thank you, Assistant Director Wiesner. I'm trying to find you on the screen. There you are. Hey, Steve. Really very much for all the work that your shop has been able to accomplish in really terrible environment. The 2016-2017 storms had a huge impact on all of our county infrastructure. And while we had to figure out some way to pay for and repair all those things in really restrictive timelines, you were still able to deliver normal county services to everyone. We're still delivering road projects. And I want to highlight in particular the current resurfacing program. Our pavement management program has been consistently unfunded. And I recall that when I first started working for the county, our conversations with Public Works were really, really grim. Not only were all of our roads failing, but there was zero money to do anything about it. And that was every year we met with Public Works, and that was the story. Until Measure D certainly gave us some advantage in grant seeking and gave us a little bit of money for local streets and roads. But I think what has really been fundamentally changing the game for us at the county has been the RTC's reconsideration of its policies regarding disbursement of RSTPX, STBG funding from the federal government, instead of making it an internally competitive grant program within the RTC. We voted a couple of years ago in this grant cycle to try dispersing the money directly to the jurisdictions to allow them to do the projects that were important to them. And that resulted in $4.3 million in new surface street money for the Santa Cruz County Department of Public Works. So that 26 miles of roads that we were able to do as compared to the 4 miles of roads we were doing previously is due in no small part to the RTC changing this policy. So really, I want to thank the commission, because there are several projects that we're now building. Pioneer stands out, that would never ever have been built if it hadn't been for this money. So when this grant cycle comes up again and we reconsider the policy again, I hope that.
We lost you, Mike. Patrick, you there?
Seems to be frozen.
A host of projects sitting on a shelf that are ready to go, but have no funding. And so this opportunity has been just huge for us. And I want to thank everybody for all their work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Andy Schiffer.
Thank you. I'm just going to echo what other people have said about the Public Works Department. The third district, supervisorial district, probably has the fewest mileage in roads. But we have, it's pretty much a rural area and it has lots of needs. And we appreciate the work that the department has been doing to respond to those needs in terms of trying to keep the roads open and manageable and improved. So again, thank you, Steve, and your department for the work that you do. And as you know, we're working with the department on numerous projects in our district, as I know you're working in other areas as well. I wanted to echo also what Commissioner Rodkin said about the segment of the rail trail that has been completed. I use it at least once a week, walking the whole trail on Sunday morning. I've also used it a number of times on a fairly regular basis on my bicycle. And it's unfortunate if there was an accident on there, but I've been there where there are lots of people, and although not as intense as Westcliff, and it's, you know, worked very well. People are responsible, as most people are generally responsible. And let me say, one of the things that I've really enjoyed about the bike path, and what makes me really feel strongly to urging the commission to continue to build the trail segments, is how quiet it is. Not walking along the road, not riding a bike along the road. It's not just a matter of safety, it's just the noise level is so different. And it's such a pleasure to walk along a bike path where you're not hearing cars and motorcycles and trucks and God knows what zooming by. So I in my opinion, the segment is well used. It's relatively safe. For most of it, there isn't a fence on both sides. There is always a fence on the side adjacent to the tracks, but for most of the way, there's a distance between the trail and adjacent fences, if there are fences at all. So again, thank you very much, Steve, for your presentation and for the work that the department does.
Thank you. Is there any other commissioners that'd like to speak
Mr. Chair?
Oh, go ahead, Commissioner.
I thought I'd put a participant. Certainly, I want to reiterate my I can't overstate my appreciation for County Public Works. In the County of Santa Cruz has experienced, you know, natural disasters 2016 to this 17 to this year. You know, it's going to be a long time to catch up because there's so much the depth of the monetary need that we have. But I also want to thank the voters of Santa Cruz County who approved Measure D. You know, the good thing about that is it includes all forms of transportation. And I think it's evident from this presentation by Deputy Director C. Wiesner that we are including bike, pedestrian, vehicular, and considering rail and so forth. Everything was included, and everybody can say you wouldn't have passed it without my support, and they're right. But we needed everybody's support to pass it is the point. And to implement it the way you are, to serve all modes of transportation is much appreciated. And we're saying we're doing what we said we were gonna do. So I think the voters of Santa Cruz County should be pleased with how we're progressing with our Measure D funds. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Is there any other commissioner that would like to speak at this time? Seeing none. Well, thank you, Steve, for your presentation. I just wanna echo what all the fellow commissioners have said. I know you showed the Trouch Gulch project signal light there, and it reminded me back in the days when I was working in construction with a company that did the upgrading for the sewer line in that area. And they gave me the task of being the actual traffic controller in that intersection. And that was a very challenging thing to control traffic. And I was like a policeman in the middle of the intersection, controlling all four in all the directions of traffic. It's good to see that there's a light there, and alleviates some of that traffic congestion, because being a flagman in the middle of an intersection that's that highly occupied is extremely it's an experience that I'll never forget. I actually got a coffee from some folks that appreciated me moving the traffic along so smoothly, those good projects. I know there's a lot of deferred maintenance for many years. I've been a long-term resident of this county, and I know it's going to take a while for us to catch up, but I think we need to continue to press on and also always keep in mind our pedestrians and bicyclists. But I do have one question. Well, actually, I have two questions. And I do, on the Houlihan and 152 project, I really want to make sure that we move that forward as fast as possible for the safety for the children that go from Lakeview to their houses. There's a lot of students that travel that path. And then the other one is on the Lakeview. I understand we're gonna be building a roundabout at the intersection of 129 and Lakeview, is that correct?
So that is a Caltrans project. I think Scott, if he's still on, he could probably speak to that. I'm aware of it, but it really is a Caltrans project.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to go ahead and bring it back to the take it to the public now for any questions or comments on your presentation. And I noticed we have Mr. Ben Benazza.
Yes, Steve, good job. You got a lot of responsibility, a lot of projects going. I want to talk about Aptos and State Park Drive. That's very significant. And when you go to start State Park Drive, remember, if we rail bank, one of the first trails to start is from Monterey Park Drive to La Selva Beach. That's six crossings of other streets. Two of them are controlled now in Aptos Village, and maybe you have something going for State Park Drive. That would leave only four that are uncontrolled crossings, and that's Mar Vista Drive, State Park Drive, unless you do something there, Clubhouse Drive, and going into Seascape, and you're all the way. 7 miles to Seascape, through Seascape to La Selva from Capitola. The other thing is the Mar Vista overpass. Once that's completed, and with the trail there, the transportation system in Mid-County is absolutely fantastic. You will see so many e-bikes, so many scooters, so many elderly in their eight chairs, kids. It's going to be great. The school's on one side of the freeway, Mar Vista. Now they don't have to have that. They can come from Rio Del Mar, and they can go to the coastal, to Mar Vista, over, and they're there. So it's a wonderful transportation system, and I encourage you to rail bank and start first on Capitola to La Selva Beach Rail. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair Brian Peoples, and then Paul.
Mr. Peoples.
Mr. Peoples?
Mr. Peoples, Ms. Brian Peoples?
Here we are.
No, yeah. There. I'm on. You didn't disconnect it. Thank you, Brian from Trail Now. Hey, Steve, good to see you again. How you been? Hey, I got one word for you, roundabouts. Can we get more roundabouts? I think they work fabulous. I do want to remind the commission, you know, we were Trail Now was a PAC initially when Measure D came out as opposing it because they had 25% of the funds going to a train, and the RTC adjusted the language and diverted the money to Metro and other areas. And we became a supporter of it. And we're proud of that, being a team player on that. One note on the Aptos Village, as a reminder, there's no train station in Aptos Village. The plan is actually for trains to fly through there every 15 minutes. So when you talk to the PUC, the entire village shuts down every 15 minutes. So, and I think this brings up the issue that Commissioner Koenig's really pointing out. In industry, when you design something, you understand what your requirements are and what your goal is. And what happens if you're designing something that's not a feasible project, you're over designing it. When we looked at those photos that you showed, that looked like a very expensive elevated trail next to this old railroad track. And actually you're not designing it to meet the requirements of a commuter train. The federal guideline requires that a train traveling over 25 miles an hour be separated from a trail by 25 feet. So I think that's the main thing that Commissioner Koenig was pointing out, is we're wasting a lot of money on a design that doesn't even meet the requirements of your train. Does that make sense? That is really poor public policy. And then finally, I'll talk about the Valencia Road when it shut down. Remember when it flooded? Well, my wife's a teacher at Valencia Elementary School. We actually live over off Quail Run up by the post office. She normally would ride her bike to school. It's a half a mile. But when that bridge went out for like a year, she had to go all the way around Freedom Boulevard. And that's really our point about the coastal trail. We're sitting here 10 years now, not using that resource. And it's causing us to go all the way around and not leveraging that, basically that transportation resource. So that's the frustrating part for the community. And I do appreciate, Steve, you coming on, and your boss Matt is a great guy. Over.
Thank you, Mr. Peoples.
Ms. Segal.
Hi.
Ms. Segal.
Yes. Thank you. I just wanted to give a huge shout out thanks to the County of Santa Cruz Public Works Department. So thank you very much, Steve. And we are so excited here at Friends of the Rail Trail to see this starting on segments 10 and 11 of the rail trail, see all the walkability projects that are happening in each of the villages and all of the connections that are being made. So thank you so much. These are hugely popular projects among the county, and you have the support of thousands behind you. So thank you again for all you're doing there.
Thank you.
Mr. Jack Harrell.
Hi, I wanted to agree with Supervisor Koenig about the lack of safety on the segment 7 section of the trail. It's true that the pedestrians I encounter are very polite, lots of families with strollers. But it means that bicycling, I have to stop and give them the right of way as I should. But it's only because of the narrowness of the trail that that's a requirement. I've actually had to stop because of a car's bumper coming across the trail. This is all while we have this open space right next to it. That's the railroad right of way with tracks on it that we can't use. We can't put some gravel on it and widen that whole trail for everybody to use. And similarly, the money we're spending for the traffic lights, what was it, $500,000 for a piece for two traffic lights, $1 million we're spending in today's dollars to provide for a train that even the wildest enthusiasts think are is 20 or 30 years away. So we're spending today's dollars for a fantasy. I think the RTC doesn't have their priorities correct. And that's my comment.
Thank you.
I do not see any other hands raised, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Well, thank you, Steve, for that report. That was a great report. Hope to see you soon again. And we can go ahead and move on now on to item number 22, financial constraints project list for 2045 transportation plans. Amy Naranjo.
Hi there. Can I get the screen share, please?
Should have it already, Amy.
It says I can't start the screen share while others are first. Okay, there we go. Thank you. Okay. Well, good morning, commissioners. Thank you for having me today. My name is Amy Naranjo, and I'm a transportation planner for the RTC. Today, I'm requesting your approval of the draft constrained project list for inclusion in the 2045 Regional Transportation Plan. This is provided in your packet as attachment one. The RTP is a state-mandated long-range transportation plan and investment strategy that's prepared every 4 years and is incorporated in the federally mandated Metropolitan Transportation Plan and the state-mandated Sustainable Community Strategy. Both of these are prepared by the Association of Monterey Bay Area Government. The projects that are projects are required to be included in the RTP and or the MTP SES in order to receive certain transportation funds. The 2045 RTP is considered a minor update, and projects on the constrained project list are similar to those that were included in the previous 2040 RTP. So the RTP includes three major elements, which then guide the development of the constrained project list. So first is the policy element, which defines the transportation goals, policies, and performance measures that have been set for the county. These have been developed using the triple bottom line approach of environment, economy, and equity. And the RTC reviewed and approved these in February of 2020. Second is the financial element. And this estimates the funds that will likely be available for transportation projects over the next 25 years. And a summary of the $5 billion in anticipated revenue sources is provided in your packet as attachment two. And third is the action element, which then identifies the complete list of transportation needs in the county through a list of projects and programs that are needed to operate, maintain, and improve the transportation system. The complete cost of transportation needs in our county is currently estimated to be approximately $9 billion over the 25-year RTP time period. So given the gap between the complete cost of transportation needs and the projected revenues through 2045, staff, with input from the project sponsors, RTC advisory committees, and members of the public, have developed recommendations for which projects should be included in the financially constrained list. The project list that's provided in your packet, it contains the full list of projects, and then it breaks out the portions that are constrained and unconstrained. So the mix of transportation projects that are proposed in the constrained list really strive to advance the performance targets that are set through 2045, with a particular emphasis on maintenance and improving the transportation options that reduce vehicle miles traveled, that reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and that support active modes of transportation. Additionally, projects that are on the constrained list include all the projects that currently have dedicated funding, projects that have already been programmed, and then projects that are prioritized for discretionary or semi-flexible funding. However, in some instances, projects which are defined, which are identified as unconstrained, may be high priorities, but given the funding constraints, they just may not be financially feasible under the current funding sources and projections. So staff's recommendation today is that the RTC approve the financially constrained project list and identify any particular projects that could be funded with projected revenues through 2045. And the RTC should inform staff at today's meeting if there are any specific projects that the RTC would like move between the constrained and the unconstrained projects list. So the next steps, once the RTC approves the constrained project list, we'll provide this project list to AMBAG, which will then determine which transportation projects undergo program level environmental review for the entire RTP and MTP SES. The draft RTP and EIR will then be released for public review in December of this year, and then the final RTP is scheduled for RTC approval in June of 2022. So that concludes my report. I'm happy to take your questions or comments. I also have Rachel Morricone of RTC staff available to answer any questions specific to the financial element, as well as Heather Adamson, Planning Director at AMBAG, to answer any specifics about the MTP SES. So with that, I'll take your questions.
Thank you, Amy.
Thank you.
Commissioner Watkins, I see your hand.
Thanks. My question is, when we develop this financially constrained list, I'm assuming that there are, there's, as you said, input from the various agencies, the cities and the county about their projects in their areas. And sometimes projects are high priority because they're good for transportation throughout the county, not necessarily to the particular area. In other words, if something's in the middle of a roadway or something, it needs to be supported by the RTC, even if it's not the highest priority for that particular public agency, the city. But I'm curious whether there are projects that are wholly within a city or within the unincorporated part of the county that where there's disagreement between the agency, the city or the county, and the RTC staff about whether it should be on or off the list. And should I just assume that the people who represent those agencies, for example, the city of Capitola, would be speaking up if they felt there was something on this list that was, they had, you know, where they would want to substitute something that's not on the list for something that is, that's totally within their city? Is that a reasonable way to assume that this process addresses the highest needs of these various agencies?
I think you assumed correctly, and the agencies have had an opportunity to review the list and to either add additional projects, remove projects, or adjust any of the descriptions and or costs that are associated with that project.
So I looked through this list. It's extensive. It took a while to read through them, and I don't know all these areas. So some of them I didn't even know what the project was. The ones in the city of Santa Cruz, I sort of grasped most of them. But I'm curious whether, just trying to, you know, understand the process. For example, do these cities formally approve the list that's in front of us? Say that we're fine with what you're recommending, or is that we've not had a formal action by these agencies before it's coming to us?
There hasn't been any formal action from the cities on, as far as I'm aware, as far as these, this list is a continuation of the previous RTP's project list, and the jurisdictions and the project sponsors in particular have looked at the project list and reviewed it, and then made their additional comments. And it's been reviewed both by the planning staff as well as the public work staff.
Great. I'm just going to state, you know, for the public record, I'm depending on the various agencies to represent their interests as they see them and let us know if there's something they're unhappy about. Otherwise, I found no problems with the list, but I'll put it back to the rest of the commissioners. Thank you.
If I may add, Doug, commissioners, sorry, Mr. Chair, may have a May I add something to what Amy commented?
Go ahead.
Okay, all right, this is Lee Spence of your staff, commissioners. And some of you who've been on the commission for some time or, you know, are aware may remember that, you know, this is something we go through every 4 years of establishing this regional transportation plan, working in cooperation with all of the local jurisdictions, with Santa Cruz Metro, other project implementers, and then also, of course, with the Association of Monterey Bay Area Governments. As part of working with all of them, we are getting input from all of those entities on what should be in the project list, and, you know, and we were, of course, providing information on what funding may be available and so on to be able to determine what may be in the constrained list or unconstrained list and so on, and also take into account the priorities of the RTC that the RTC established, the policies and goals and targets that the RTC already approved for the regional transportation plan. And this list that you're seeing today has gone to the ITAC, the Interagency Technical Advisory Committee, that has representation from all the planning departments and the public works departments, Santa Cruz Metro and others. And it also has gone to the Bicycle Advisory Committee and the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Advisory Committee for their review and input.
Thanks for that. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Luis. Commissioner Beltran.
Yeah, Michael, thanks for bringing that out, because that was something of my concern too. And as Luis mentioned, ITAC reviews this, and we in Capitola have a representative on ITAC. But I was wondering, Amy, can you give us an idea of how you proceed to review this with the city of Capitola and other cities? What's the timeline? You know, how much time do they have? And like Michael, I reviewed the projects. They seem, you know, fairly reasonable to me. But, you know, I didn't talk to Steve in our city planning department about everything that's on that list. So I was wondering, how do you initiate this review on a citywide basis?
Yeah, so in early 2020, as we were approving the draft, or that we're approving the goals, policies, and targets, staff sent out reminders to all of the local jurisdictions with their previous project list that was in the 2040 RTP. And so we sent it out for multiple times for different levels of review when the first draft was developed and then approved at the RTC in September. And so the agencies have been looking at those projects throughout. And then as we've gone to the committee meetings as well, asking for their input on specific projects and any updates.
Okay, so the ITAC, that would be a more drilled down review?
Totally, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for your response. I appreciate it.
Sorry, Commissioner Brown, I recognize you. And then Commissioner Manu Koenig.
Thank you. Just on the this question about the communication between planning and public works staff and RTC staff for the individual jurisdictions, I guess I'm just want to make sure I'm clear about the new projects that have been added. And that, Amy, am I correct in assuming that those are based on the city's and county's review of the previous list that you sent to the cities and things they just wanted to add those were communicated to you? Or is there another reason for these new projects to show up and either be constrained or unconstrained?
Yeah, during the project review, when we were soliciting new projects and new project ideas, they were primarily given from the actual project sponsors in their updates. So the updates that we received were any specific updates to the current project that was going to continue on the project list, whether that was the cost, project description, scope, and so forth. And then the direction that we received were to remove any projects that have been completed since the previous RTP, and then any new additional projects based on needs and current assessments.
And to add to Amy's comments, I think part of the process is also including the public you know, in determining whether any new projects might be needed and so on. So there was also, you know, an effort to, you know, to go out to the public and get public input. And I think you saw, I don't know if we gave you all of that public input or a summary of that public input when the draft total project list was put out by the RC, I think back in September. From some of that public input, sometimes, you know, public suggests projects, and then we provide that information to the local jurisdiction that would, you know, be responsible for the project, whatever area that's being proposed. A lot of the times, the projects suggested by the public are already included in other projects, so that, you know, they're a component of existing projects. But where that's not the case, then the local jurisdiction, you know, will let us know whether that's something that's feasible for them to add to the list or not, and so on.
We did get that list on that when we looked at the policy stuff of the hearings that were held with public and opportunities for input.
Yeah, thank you. Just a really quick follow-up. So yes, I remember seeing those. What I'm trying to figure out is one very specific piece. There's a new, it's SCEP 130 Mission Street Improvement Plan, which is new, and it is listed as with a cost of $1.5 million and all unconstrained. So I'm just trying to figure out, because that seems to be a very important area, and given the safety issues on Mission Street, you know, I would think that it would be a higher priority than what I'm seeing here. And so I'm just wondering, is that something that I just want to go talk with our city, just work on that at the city if we're trying to make any changes? Because, you know, I don't want to start tinkering here without having that conversation. But I do feel like there's at least a couple where there's, you know, these seem to be much higher priorities in terms of safety. I'm just trying to figure out how each project got, and each new project got into the plan and how it was determined where they would fall in terms of constrained versus unconstrained. So I think I get it. Anyway, thanks for helping clarify.
Thank you to Commissioner Brown. Commissioner Manu, kind of, and then back to Commissioner Brodkins. Commissioner Manu.
Great, thank you, Chair. I just want to kind of clarify what the process would be if we did want to add a project. It's all about constrained funding environment. And so if we were going to suggest adding something, would we also have to suggest removing something from the...
you got it.
Right, because I'll just point out, I can see lots of projects I would like to move from unconstrained to constrained. I mean, whether it's, you know, $6.8 million in lump sum bike projects, or a Murray Street Harbor to Path connection at $790,000, or lighting along the San Lorenzo Riverwalk at $952,000. Complete streets for Watsonville School connection, $16 million, that's on the unconstrained list. Improving 26th Avenue in the county, 2.58, which is on the unconstrained list. Even, you know, updates consistent with the sustainable Santa Cruz County plan, $15 million on unconstrained list. Yeah, I mean, we can go on and on, right? There's $4 billion worth of good projects that have been identified, which are completely unfunded. It's a much harder decision to actually try to remove some of the $5 billion projects that have been identified. So I just want to point that out we're operating in a resource-constrained environment.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rodkins, and then Commissioner Johnson.
There's no S on the end of Rodkin.
Rodkin.
Yeah, it's a common mistake. I totally want to agree with Manu about the observation. You know, these other projects are not bad projects. There's just, but the issue is, yes, what would you take off the list to be able to find the funding to do something different? That's a whole different order of magnitude. On Mission Street, the issue that Sandy Brown asked a question about, because of utility issues along the highway, along Mission Street, where the Highway 1 runs along there, and because of the lack of right-of-way ownership by the public, decision was made. We started that project in 1985 when I was still on the council. And that it was a hard decision to not put, full bike lanes on there or protected bike lanes. A decision basically was made, I think, that people in bicycles need to really ride their bicycles along California or King Street or the other alternatives that exist, rather than on the road. And because it's a quantum leap to be able to fund a project that would include reasonable bike lanes along there. And that was a hard decision to make, but that decision was made pretty much by the city council, not by the RTC, in terms of, otherwise we would have waited forever for that. We wouldn't have the improvements that we got. Mission Street used to be some places two lanes, some places three, some four. Became a total four-lane road following the RTC funding and other funding we got from Caltrans in 85. And so the decision to add that, for all the obvious, safety issues you might consider, you'd have to make a decision to sort of blow out every other project in the city of Santa Cruz and not fund it and fund that instead. And you still would be short of funding to make it happen. So I think that was the thinking that was going on at the time. And I suspect that hasn't changed. Although you could ask RT staff or the city staff about, whether they have some different view of that now, but that was the view about 10 years ago. And I'm assuming it hasn't changed.
Commissioner Gonzalez, Chris Schneider at the City of Santa Cruz would like to respond.
Good morning, this is Chris Schneider, Assistant Director of Public Works. And the Mission Street project is in our capital improvement program. And we've had a number of intersection improvement projects listed over the years as part of capacity and safety improvements at specific intersections. And this is combining them into one project, working with Caltrans to do the design and environmental review. And that's why you see that as a new project. The other new projects in there are in our capital improvement program. And, we give those the RTC to include. One of the things that we're doing is we're working on our next capital improvement program. And so we have two new projects to propose, which I'll be talking to staff about after the meeting.
Thank you, Chris.
Just to be clear, having all the projects listed in this document is great. It really helps us to get more funding for projects, et cetera. But even projects on the unconstrained list does not prevent us from getting grant funding. So for instance, the San Lorenzo River lighting, we did actually get a grant for that. So, technically it's really on the constrained list. It's 100% funded by the grant, so it's really not an issue for the list, but it's really important to have these projects listed here, whether they're unconstrained or unconstrained. It's important that they're in the system. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. I'm going to go over with Commissioner Johnson, and then Commissioner Schiffer, and then Commissioner Brown.
Thank you, Chair. Just want to bring attention to Granite Creek Road overpass with bike improvements. It's a very modest $200,000 plus another $50,000, and it just kind of underscores this is pretty dangerous. We have a school of 400 or 500 kids right there. It's very highly used. It's a modest amount if we wanted a fix, but there is kind of a fixation on Highway 1 versus Highway 17. Highway 17 gets massive numbers of cars, drivers every morning. Something like this that is very reasonable, I think. I just want to draw the attention that, we have overpasses for bikes and so forth that are in the Highway 1 plan for construction that are in the sometimes of $5, $6, $8 million. And here we have something for $250,000 that is really needed. But in some ways, I think Highway 17 all the way up gets ignored. And so I would just like staff, maybe it's beyond your efforts for Granite Creek, but just pay a little bit more attention to Highway 17. It's an important highway in our transportation system. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson. Commissioner Schiffer, Andy?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to mainly follow up on what Chris Schneider said in terms of keeping the RTP, the transportation plan, in perspective. This is a 30-year look into an imperfect look into an imperfect future where there are all sorts of uncertainties, and we do it every few years. So it's not like anything is cast in stone here. It's just, in a sense, it's everybody's wish list, and then trying to say, well, what on the wish list might be funded and what on the wish list is unlikely to be funded, and then 4 years from now, I'll do a wish list all over again. So, I mean, my sense is there's, we have to, as Chris says, it's very important to have projects on the list because you can't get them funded. The jurisdictions can't get them funded if they're not on the list. But when opportunities to fund some of these projects come along, it's not that big of a deal getting them put on the list, even between RTP timelines. So, you know, I think it's, you know, the final point is that it's never enough. I appreciate what Commissioner Johnson is saying, but every month when I look at the Caltrans report, there seem to be lots of projects on Highway 17. So I think it's, you know, it's not enough. If you want to widen Highway 1, the projects that the commission is funding is not enough. If you want to build out the rail trail, the amount of money isn't enough. Whatever, as we've seen them to do passenger rail, there doesn't seem to be sufficient funding. So the challenge is always finding the resources to carry out the range of projects that that the commission as a whole and the jurisdictions individually want to do. And I think that's what the regional transportation plan is, just the federal requirement that tells the commission and the various jurisdictions that if you think you might want to do one of these projects, you better put it in the plan. And so I think that's really what it does.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Brown.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to be clear. Perhaps my question wasn't framed as clearly as I would have liked, but I understand that this is the laundry list, kind of inventory wish list. I understand that there are many great projects on here, and I understand the constraints on Mission Street. What I'm talking about here is just simply, and it was an example of trying to figure out how it is that we identify or, you know, try to, what we can do to help some of these projects rise to the top, because it's a matter of like of public safety. It's a safety hazard. Not that I know there's no chance of bike lanes on Mission Street. I'm talking about specific intersection improvements, the kinds of things that are on this list. And I'm just trying to understand how it is that we, you know, when we, you know, we have the big list, but certain projects get done and certain ones don't from this list over time. The list changes. I'm not questioning that process. I'm just trying to figure out how it is that we can, either at the RTC level, or perhaps this is an issue for, you know, me as an individual council member to try to get on the city council agenda. I just am trying to make sure that I walk away from this understanding, you know, what the channels are, I guess. So perhaps, Mr. Schneider, you can help me understand that. Would this be a matter of talking with colleagues and trying to connect with you about, you know, where the chances of, you know, safety improvements on Mission are, since they're in this list, like where they're headed?
I'm not sure I've been unmuted.
You are now. We hear you.
Yes, we definitely can have that discussion about what the priorities are for you and for the council as a whole.
Thanks.
Thank you, commissioners. Commissioner Rod Kim.
Thanks. Sandy, I was not in any way attacking your question. It was a totally reasonable one. I'm just defensive as a bicycle rider and activist that, you know, we weren't able to build those bike lanes. And I believe me, I've gotten a rash of complaints over many years from close friends and enemies about not having delivered bike lanes on Mission. So it was more my defensiveness than any kind of a critique of what your question was. Thank you.
Thank you, commissioners. I know we really care about our communities, and we really want our projects to be out in forefront before everybody else's, especially the city of Watsonville that has been so far behind in a lot of their projects. So with that, I'm gonna go and take it to the public for any questions.
Brian Peoples.
Comments.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Commissioner Brown, Commissioner Johnson, absolutely you're right. It's not clear the prioritization criteria set on the decision factors. It's not really clear on this. So I think you're absolutely right for asking for clarity on that. One other thing I would also suggest is clarity on how you come up with your ROM, your rough order of magnitude on the cost estimates. And I'll reference the segment 7 phase 2, which you have priced in for $11 million on page 22-14. You know, initially when segment 7 came out as a cost estimate, it was estimated at $2.5 million. That quickly went up, and actually 7A turned out to be $8 million. And that was the easy segment, considered the most easy, simplest segment to do. Segment phase 2 has huge retaining walls. You have to deal with Roaring Camp Railroad. So my question would be is, how are we recalculating based on actuals? And are we doing that as part of this effort? Because it feels like a lot of your criteria that you are setting is based off of two things, is the price or the cost, as well as the bucket that it fits in. And so to say you're bucketing it by the cities, by Caltrans, by all that, rather than criteria that may be more suitable, like safety, as Commissioner Brown said. So my question would be, are you keeping up with the ROM cost estimates? Because of that feels like a lot of your planning is based off of the cost. And so if that's one of your primary drivers, then you should be keeping up with that. And anytime you have an actual to go to, you should use that. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Peoples.
Ms. Segal.
Thank you, commissioners. In reviewing the constrained project list of Friends of the Rail Trail are so excited to see rail trail segments 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and 18 have all been selected to receive all the funding needed to construct and open them for public use. This is wonderful. Furthermore, we are pleased to see that all the remaining segments will receive further funding. Thank you. Completing the rail trail will improve mobility for generations to come. We also applaud a number of other important projects that have been included in the constrained project list, including the Live Oak Transfer Hub at 17th Avenue and many rail line projects, including $25 million that have been allocated to advancing public transit on the Watsonville-Santa Cruz Rail Corridor. However, we noted the funding for all these rail line projects totals only $42 million, far less than the projected $73 million generated by Measure D specifically for the rail corridor. Accordingly, CORE urges the Commission to move the following projects to the constrained project list to take advantage of that rail corridor dedicated funding. These recommendations are $25 million for freight service upgrades, which will upgrade the rail line, allowing for more reasonable ongoing maintenance of the line, and $5.34 million for recreational rail infrastructure, which will demonstrate the county's commitment to meeting the terms of the Proposition 116 funds that were used to purchase the rail line. Adding these two additional projects to the constrained list will increase the total funding allocated to the rail line to about $72 million, consistent with the voter-approved Measure D expenditure plan and without even touching the $375 million in other discretionary funds at the Commission's disposal. We look forward to seeing these projects included, and thank you for all you're doing.
Thank you.
Mr. Barry Scott?
Yes, thank you. I want to welcome all the new commissioners, and when I look at these agenda packets, I try to imagine what is it like for a brand new RTC commissioner to go over all of this information. It reminds me how important it is that we have a commission, and how much work it is to really drill down through all of these different projects. But I thank you for all of the investments that you're making across the board. And I want to echo Faina's comments, that including thank you for all of the trail investments that are identified, but also she picked out the very same two unconstrained line items that I had made notes of, RTC P41 improvements to Class 2 and RTC 25 recreational. In the amounts of $25 million and $5.3 million. Because both of these are the commitments to the future of this rail line, commitment to future generations. It's known around the world that rail transit is effective, efficient, and over the life of a system, more cost-effective than alternatives. I also want to say, and I can never say this enough, it's not rail versus metro, and it's certainly not rail versus trail. We need all of the above, and this rail system is likely to improve metro's bottom line, metro's ridership, and metro's revenue streams, because the state permits funding of shuttle services in support of rail systems. Let's, you know, we don't have a rail interest group so much that's able to chime in. We have our bikes and our elderly and so forth. You know, maybe speaking for future travelers, let's make sure that we express the commitment to modern transit and move a little money over into those buckets and constrain some funds for the future. That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Scott.
Mr. Vernassa?
Yes, in response to several comments, I would like to suggest that Metro probably has the best opportunity over rail. It has the possibility to service everything that you think you can do with a train that a train won't do. Look at Marin County. Look at the state's system. That's dead in the water in the valley. The Metro you should consider as one of the choices and the only choice when you come to vote on it on the business plan. Bus plus trail. Bus plus trail. That's where it's at and gives the best service to our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
I do not see any other hands up, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Okay, can bring it back. Can I hear a motion?
Move the staff recommendation.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Andy and a second by Mr. Rutkins.
And I have a quick comment on the motion, if I might.
Go ahead, Mr. Rutkins.
So it's a not appropriate time, I think, to make the addition being proposed by the Fort, Friends of the Rail Trail. And Barry Scott, I think, supported that as well. My view is that if we're working on a business plan, that's our next step, really, and they're looking at the rail possibilities. And my understanding, I should be corrected right now if I'm wrong, is that it's possible to amend this plan. We don't have to wait 5 years. If it were to turn out that the business plan suggested we really should be moving forward more quickly with rail, I don't know that it will come out that way, but if it were to move that way, I believe we have the ability to amend this plan. And if they're correct,
that adding it would be simply using Measure D money that's already available and not fighting with other projects would be the kind of thing I would support. But I would wait, I wouldn't change the motion that's on the floor now. I would wait till we see the business plan and what that what tells us about what our, you know, the realistic possibilities that are there for rail transit. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other commissioner that'd like to comment? Seeing none and hearing none.
Mr. Chair, before the commission votes on the motion, if I'd like to just add one thing, I think Chris Schneider, the Assistant Director of Public Works City of Santa Cruz, he said that he's going to talk to staff about a project that is on the unconstrained list, but it's got funding that should be on the constrained list. So just want to the commission to consider that your motion include, you know, minor corrections that might be needed, you know, in talking with local jurisdictions, whether it be, you know, if there's a project that needs to be added to the constrained list, as Mr. Schneider said, that you actually do have the funding and it is constrained. Or also we continue to work with local jurisdictions on, you know, their updates to, or everybody else, you know, updates to cost estimates and so on, and it was mentioned by a member of the public on how we take into account, you know, actual costs, and we do. That's why we update this plan every 4 years. Work with local jurisdictions. If there are updates to costs, we certainly do that, and we've learned that there might be, you know, a few projects that need some minor updates.
It's acceptable to me as a maker of the motion to add direction that staff continue to work with local jurisdiction staff to make any minor clarifications that seem appropriate and to make any updates in the information in the RTP that seems relevant and acceptable to the jurisdictions.
My understanding is that wouldn't mean bumping some big project off of the list to make space for something, but simply adjusting things where that's possible. And on that basis, I agree with Andy. I'm happy to have that added to the motion.
Yeah. With that, is there any other comments from the commissioners before I ask for roll call? Could I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Bertrand?
I agree.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson?
Aye.
Commissioner Montesino?
Yes.
Commissioner Caput?
Aye.
Commissioner Alternate Schifrin?
Aye.
Commissioner Alternate Mulher?
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
Aye.
Commissioner McPherson?
Aye.
Commissioner Peterson?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Rotkin?
Aye.
With that, that is approved. We're going to go ahead and move on to item 23, federal and state legislative updates. Rachel.
Good morning, commissioners. Rachel Morricone of your staff. And in recognition of what time it is now, I'm just going to quickly go over highlight some of the points that are listed, especially in attachment one of the staff report of different legislative activities that have been happening. The Regional Transportation Commission does annually adopt or approve a legislative program. You most recently looked at this at your February meeting and accepted the legislative program. It's included as a attachment two. We use this to help inform staff and commissioner comments on different legislative actions that might come up throughout the calendar year. On both the state and federal level, one of the focus areas, especially recently, has been on COVID relief proposals. At the end of December, Congress approved the Coronavirus Response and Relief Supplemental Appropriation Act, or HR 133, or CRISA, depending on who you're talking to give it some new acronyms. What that bill did was for transportation, it included a lot of support for health and safety and some stimulus money. But on the transportation side, it included $14 billion for transit, which includes about $13 million that will be coming to Santa Cruz Metro. And then about $911 million coming to California through the Federal Highway Administration. And distribution on how those funds will flow is still something that's under discussion. That we've had a few meetings with California Transportation Commission and Caltrans staff. It's most likely to be distributed on a 40%, 60% split between regional agencies and the state for the SHOP. And as far as how the regional funds will go out, we anticipate, based on the latest proposals, that the CTC will recommend distributing those funds through the State Transportation Improvement Program or a regional surface transportation program like program. So we will know hopefully by the end of this month how much money that is. We're thinking it's probably in the $2 to $3 million ballpark figure estimate, and we'll be coming back to you with recommendations on programming those funds if indeed the funds do flow through regional agencies. Congress today, actually the Senate this morning started debate on a new American Rescue Plan, which is a $1.9 trillion proposal from the Biden administration, which the House approved in the wee hours of last Saturday, which could include, depending on what happens at the Votorama that the Senate is undergoing over the next few days, $30 billion nationwide for transit and $350 billion for states and local governments. There's no federal highway funding in that proposal right now. I don't anticipate that the Senate will amend it to include federal highway funds, but it is something that we're tracking, and I know a lot of our local agencies are looking forward to having some relief for the revenue losses that they've incurred over the last 2 years. The next step after that gets approved, President Biden and House and Senate leaders have started talking about a more massive infrastructure bill that would include transportation, water, housing, and schools, and a few other infrastructure components. The focus there on the transportation side is on shovel-worthy instead of shovel-ready projects. There'd be a few years for agencies to put projects into place. They might, as part of that, address the Federal Transportation Act reauthorization. And on the House side, there has been a call to congressional legislators to identify any possible earmarks. So we are tracking that. We have many projects, as discussed earlier in this meeting and by both the Public Works Director for the county and city and all the projects in the regional transportation plan that could be implemented quickly. But on page 23-6 of your packet, there's a quick list of some of the preliminary projects that local jurisdictions have identified that they could put that money to work within the next 6 to 18 months on if it were available. Also in our legislative program, attachment 2, I think it's page 200 of the PDF, is a list of as well as page 208, is a list of some of the local priority projects, including our projects on Highway 1, transit projects, local street and road repairs, and the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Senior Trail that we would be proposing if earmarks do become a reality. On the federal level, related to the Federal Transportation Act reauthorization, they really are focusing on bringing existing facilities into a state of good repair. This includes bridges, roads, transit systems, also addressing climate change and conversion of our vehicle fleets, both freight, transit, and passenger to zero emission vehicles or ZEV. The e-bike proposal, which Director Preston mentioned earlier, that has been put forward by Congressman Panetta. Congress is still struggling with how to fund this, especially as vehicles become more fuel efficient. The gasoline tax, which hasn't been raised by the feds since 1993, really is not cutting it. It does not cover the cost of all of our projects. And as shown in the regional transportation plan, even assuming all the different funding sources and special grants that we think we can compete for, we're still only going to have enough money to cover about half of what the needs are or the desires that have been identified. So Congress is going to be struggling with that. There's a lot of hesitancy to support a gasoline tax. I'm not sure if they'll look at a per mile fee or some other type of vehicle registration fee, but they're looking at a variety of different options, and it'll probably be a tiered implementation that will happen over, you know, 15 years or so. But that is something that they're struggling to deal with right now. On the state level, we are tracking Newsom. Governor Newsom presented his budget proposal back in January, so we've been tracking that and discussions at the legislative level, at the state legislative level, on specific proposals. The state legislators introduced over 2,500 bills already for this two-year session that began. A lot of them are focused on climate change, zero emission vehicles, resiliency, fire prevention, as well as some modifications to the way things like the regional transportation plan and sustainable community strategy is implemented. And then in recognition of our transition to so many meetings like today's, there are discussions about making some more permanent changes to the Brown Act and how we conduct public meetings, and that would apply to public agencies statewide, and to make sure that they're accessible and sometimes encourage more public participation than we're able to have in-person meetings. At the state level, the California State Transportation Agency, CALSTA, has started drafting something called the Climate Action Plan for Transportation Infrastructure. This CAPTI is expected to be released for public review later this month. They have some workshops that they'll be hosting, and it generally proposes to change some of the ways that state funding is distributed. The planning documents that Caltrans and its partner agencies at the state level produce, as well as climate resiliency and mitigations. And I won't go through this full list, but there are, you know, an increased emphasis on rail and transit and bike and pedestrian infrastructure and zero emission vehicles within the initial list of ideas that they are anticipating releasing in this draft plan. Today, we just have one primary recommendation for you, which is just to make sure that we have clarity. Our chair and vice chair are going to be attending Central Coast Coalition Lobby Day with Sacramento legislators and agencies this month. But throughout the year, we would like to just ensure that we have the board's authority to provide input to legislative and administrative proposals that are consistent with the RTC's 2021 state and federal legislative programs, which are included as attachment two. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Rachel. Is there any questions from the commissioners? Commissioner Patrick.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Rachel. Nice to see you. When do we expect the next round of STBG grant funding will be coming to us for approval?
Sure. So the Surface Transportation Block Grant Funds, or the, which we also sometimes call the Regional Surface Transportation Program Funds, RSTP or STBG, those are based on what happens at the federal level. So the current federal act, the FAST Act, expires in September of 2021. We are anticipating that the next act will include a similar type program. Maybe they'll change the name of it again. But we do have some preliminary estimates of how much money we anticipate each year. And Currently, the commission has programmed all the funds out through fiscal year 2021. So I anticipate that we would issue a call for projects or start the discussions on how to program those funds once we see what some of the initial proposals in the federal act are. And then again, I would recommend, because it is a odd odd calendar year, it's also the year that we would be selecting projects for any state transportation improvement program funds, and to kind of look at those as well as any kind of new COVID relief funding collectively, rather than run three or four different cycles for the different funding sources. So I think we'll hopefully have a little more clarity this spring and have the commission selecting those projects no later than December of this calendar year.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Is there any other commissioner that has any questions or comments? Seeing none, I'll take this out to the public.
Mr. Vernassa?
Yeah, I want to tell you about a new development that's significant. The House bill had in it the $150 million for BART extension from Fremont, San Jose, Santa Clara. That's been withdrawn. It's not in the bill anymore. So don't count on getting all this money, because it's one of the problems we have is interest rates are going up because we've borrowed so much already from ourselves, one pocket to the other, and it's going to get tougher. So that's all I have to say. And thank you very much. I will say this, I'm sort of zoomed out, because I had an early morning, like 5 o'clock in the morning, Zoom in London, in Detroit, and here with me. So I'm going to take my nap. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
There are no other hands up, Commissioner Gonzalez.
There is no. I don't see no other hands from the public. So we'll go ahead and bring this back.
I'll move the staff recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion by Andy and a second by Eduardo.
By Mr. Rockin.
Oh, okay. I seen Eduardo's hand go up. That's why.
It's up to you.
Go ahead, Mr. Rockin. Second it.
Commissioner Bertrand?
I agree.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson? Aye. Commissioner Montesino?
Yes.
Commissioner Caput?
Aye.
Commission Alternate Shiffrin?
Aye.
Commission Alternate Mulhern?
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
Aye.
Commissioner McPherson?
Aye.
Commissioner Peterson?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Rockin?
Aye.
Thank you. We're going to go ahead and move on to item 24, review of items to be discussed in closed session.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have two items in closed session today, both real property negotiations. Mr. Chairman, we do not anticipate a reportable action coming out of closed session.
Thank you. Thank you, commissioners. Thank you to the community and those out there. We will be going to closed session now.
So you should have a separate link, commissioners that are new to the board, for the closed session item. If you don't, please let me know and we'll get that to you.
There would have been an email from Ian Berry this morning around 8 o'clock.
Yeah, I got it.
Thank you.
Okay. See you in 5 minutes.